You should be good to begin, Madam President.
All right, that sounds so weird. All right. Okay, good afternoon, though it does feel like good evening. This is the regular board meeting of the Adelanto Elementary School District. It is Tuesday, January 11th, 2022. Okay, next one. Can I get a call to order? Can we take roll, please?
Yes, Madam President. Trustee Eckes?
Present.
Trustee Turner?
Turner, present.
Trustee Benz?
Benz, present.
I'll take note that Trustee LaFrench is running late and the time is 5:32.
5:32, yes, thank you. Okay, let's go ahead and go to 1.04, Pledge of Allegiance. Please stand. Place your right hand over your heart and ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. I got to put my blanket because our heater is going out. All right, let's go on to two. Adoption of the agenda 2.01, proposed additions, deletions, and adjustments in the order of business.
Madam President, we do not have any.
Thank you. 2.02. Can I get a motion to adopt the agenda?
Yes, I motion.
Okay. Can I get a second?
Trustee Turner, I second.
Thank you. Can I get a vote, please?
Trustee Eckes?
Aye.
Trustee Turner?
Trustee Turner, aye.
And Trustee Benz.
Benz, aye. Motion passes 3-0. Okay, moving on to section three, closed session. Declarations. We will be taking items 3.02 and 3.05 into closed session. Do I have to read all those? Or are we good? Okay, we're good. Okay, all right, here we go. For public testimony before closed session, do I have a representative from, please read the thing.
Yeah, I'll read that now. Thank you, Madam President. Public comment period for closed session items listed on the agenda within the subject matter jurisdiction of the governing board. The public comment period is administered by state law and is the point of the meeting is set aside for members of the public to share their opinions with the board. Open meeting laws do not prevent the board to engage in dialogue or answer questions. The health, well-being, and public safety of community members, public officials, and employees is a top priority for Adelanto Elementary School District, consistent with the shelter-in-place orders from the governor and some of the county board members and staff may participate in this meeting via Zoom. Now, this meeting is in compliance with the governor's executive order, AB 361, which will provide local legislative bodies with the continued flexibility to meet remotely without adhering to all of the Brown Act's teleconferencing rules during a proclaimed state of emergency, but with the following key limitations. Number one, public comment must be allowed in real time. Number two, there are if there are technological issues, the meeting must be stopped and no vote or other official action can be taken until the public can once again participate in the proceeding. Protocols for speakers. Any person who wishes to address the governing board on a closed session item, only must complete and submit AESD speaker request form 5 minutes before the meeting is called to order. If the comment is about something that is not on the agenda, it will be heard only through the public comment on non-agendized items, period. Once that part of the meeting is over, comments will only be taken on agenda items during the discussion of those items. The board values public comments, and although we cannot take action or discuss them not on the agenda, we listen carefully and appreciate input from the public. Additionally, a speaker can be cut off for exceeding a lot of time or for willfully causing an actual disruption to the meeting. Before cutting a person off or removing someone, the board will give at least one clear warning. If you were cut off or warned last time, please consider that your warning. Individual speakers are allowed 3 minutes to address the board on each closed session item. The board limits the total time for public input on each item to 20 minutes. With board consent, the president may increase or decrease the time allowed for public presentation, depending on the topic and the number of persons wishing to be heard. The president may take a poll of speakers for or against a particular issue and may ask an additional person to speak only if they have something new to add. That's 4.01, Madam President.
All right, thank you for that. Do we have a speaker from ADTA?
No, we do not, Madam President.
How about CSEA?
No, we do not.
We're closed. And how about audience members 4.003?
No, we do not.
On closed session. Okay. Thank you. Okay. So I guess we're going to recess to closed session. Can I please get a motion? Okay, so I'll get the motion from Trustee Ekus and the second from Trustee Turner.
I'll go ahead and take the vote. Trustee Ekus?
Aye.
Trustee Turner?
Trustee Turner, aye.
Trustee Benz?
Benz, aye. Motion passes 3-0. The time is now 5:38. Okay. I will see you on the other side.
All right.
Okay.
How about that? Okay. Are we recording? Okay. Good evening. Well, welcome back. Let's go ahead and go to reconvene open session 6.01, call to order 6.02. Roll call, please.
Yes. Trustee Ekus?
Here.
Trustee LaFrench?
Here.
Trustee Turner?
Trustee Turner, present.
Trustee Benz?
Benz, present.
Madam President, also would like to say that Trustee LaFrench joined closed session at 5:42 p.m. this evening. And the time is 8:10.
8:10, thank you. Okay, there was nothing to report. So let's go down to public testimony. Do we have a representative from AADTA?
Yes, Madam President. The board recognizes Nanette Cadilli, president of ADTA. Thank you. Ms. Cadilli?
I do see her here. I've asked her to unmute.
Okay. Do you think she needs some help?
There she is.
I see her. Thank you.
Okay. Hi, sorry. I didn't hear what you guys had called me. I'm going to turn my camera off. Mm-hmm. I can't hear anybody. Dr. Mitchell, are you there?
Yes, we hear you loud and clear, Nanette. Can you hear me, Nanette? We hear you loud and clear. You're on mute. Nanette?
Do we want to come back to her?
Yeah, I think she's texting me. Why don't we, the board invite Diane Lynn?
Okay, I'm being told you can hear me, but I couldn't hear anybody. Okay. good evening, President Bentz, trustees, Dr. Mitchell, cabinet, and everyone here tonight. I'm Nanette Cadilli, ADTA president. I spoke last week, but there are a few things I need to say that are important. I hope you've been updated on the whirlwind that is happening right now. We are missing a lot of teachers, admin, students, and classified members in all capacities. Whole classrooms are being sent home, offices with no office staff, school sites with no admin. The pertinent questions are, how are we functioning? How will we be able to continue to function like this before it all falls apart? It's like the district and the state want everything to function as usual. All of the state testing and benchmarks and LPAC are all still a go, but what are you really expecting from it? What kind of scores are you anticipating? Our teachers are always blamed for the scores and where we sit in relation to the rest of California. And this happens no matter what the circumstances are. We have bigger learning gaps from the last 2 years, and it continues as more and more students are absent this year. Please think about your expectations of scores and what actually can be taught to its full capacity at this time. Another important aspect I'd like you to realize is that teachers and staff are out of sick time, or they're about to be out, and they are worried, as should be. This reality is going to result in people coming to work while sick or prolonged. We need more sick time. That's the bottom line. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Cadilli. The board recognizes Diane Lynn. Hey, unmute yourself.
Good evening, President Bentz, trustees, Dr. Mitchell, cabinet, classified staff, certificated staff, and all others attending this meeting. I just wanted to inform you, probably a lot of you already know, we had a meeting Saturday regarding our new issues for the contact tracing that we were told for the protocols, and that the protocols would be sent out or posted by Sunday evening, because cabinet were meeting Sunday afternoon. And that if we didn't have the information by Sunday night, it would be available by Monday morning. So I and many others were periodically checking Sunday night. Nothing was posted. Some checked before we left for work on Monday, and also when we arrived at work. No information was available. So, needless to say, we were not organized. We did not look very professional, and we did not live up to the expectations for our parents and our community. We had several calls regarding when their students are to be tested. We didn't have answers for them. We told them that someone from our district to be patient, that we had a new company. I mean, the company was out and our district was. We received from the same parents 3 to 4 phone calls. A simple email could have been sent out to all of us, letting us know that, we're still in transition. Please let your parents know that we won't be calling them till tomorrow. That did not happen. When something like that happens, we all look bad. It's Adelanto Elementary School District all the way around. So we could have stopped a lot of those calls from coming in. We had many other things that we had to get done. And here we were. We didn't get any information till later that the calls were going to be going out the following day. So that's one issue. I wanted to speak upon the HEAL 360. We had many calls the day before, which was Monday. Ours happened to be today at 12:45 to 2:30. We were happy to let them know the previous day that yes, we're going to be testing students, parents, and the community could come out because that's what we were told. They were at Westside Park before they arrived at our school. And I called the over there secretary to find out, hey, you know, are we going to be on time? Because our parents have been waiting since 10:45, waiting in line, 10:45. Well, I come to find out that the secretary said, I have one of them with me right here in front of my desk, and they're not leaving Westside Park until 1:30. So I'm thinking, okay, how long does it take them to set up? We had two places. We had one line for staff and students, and we had another line for the community on the other side, and we were all prepared, and we had to go out and tell these parents that they would not be arriving to possibly 1:45. So they stayed in line. Then we get another call later saying that they were only going to be able to test the students and staff only. We had other members, other classified, well, teachers from other school sites, you know, when are they going to come? Because I have to go back to work. We didn't know what to tell them. They finally arrived. I think it was about 2:15. We had to go out and tell them that they were no longer going to be able to be tested if they were part of the community. Only staff and students were going to be able to be tested. The line left. They asked at that time, this was probably before they had left Westside Park. They all went to Westside Park because I told them that they were leaving Westside Park at 1:30. So they went to Westside Park and they were denied. So some of them came back, some of them went home. As it turns out, we did have some come in. We did allow staff members from other schools to come in and be tested. We had them come in through the front door. And our staff, we did not have a sub to relieve our teachers who were on site. So our administrators had to do that. And then it was the end of the day, so it made it a little bit easier, but everybody had to stay later. There was a line kept continued to grow for the community, and finally we had another set of 3 come in to help take this task on. What all I can say about this is we have a huge issue with communication. It's a big problem. And it is a bullet on our speed of trust that we go over every single meeting. How can we effectively run our offices without communication and provide excellent customer service? Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
The board recognizes Jessica Lemming. Jessica Lemming. You're on mute, Ms. Lemming. You're on mute. There you go.
Hi. Hello. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for taking the time to hear me out. I'm speaking on behalf of my classroom at Eagle Ranch. I'm a fifth grade teacher there, and I just wanted to say thank you, Dr. Mitchell, for hearing me. Thank you, board members. I've never spoken to you guys before, so it's kind of a nerve-wracking, but I'm gonna go ahead and go forward with this. I just wanna thank you guys for your leadership during this difficult time of COVID. I know it hasn't been easy for any of us, but I am a teacher at Eagle Ranch, and for the second time this year, my classroom has undergone a COVID outbreak. The students and their families are always my top priority, and so I was hoping to express my class's experience with COVID. We did remove our previous contact tracing company as a district, and we are now struggling as a school district to contain the surge of Omicron. I am thankful, though, for my administrator, my staff, my parents, my guardians, and their students, their children, for trying their best to comply with all of our COVID protocol that we've been informed of as of today. But unfortunately, I do feel that the COVID protocol that we currently have in place is not enough. Staff, parents, guardians, and students are being notified inefficiently of COVID protocol, which includes school and district directives on obtaining COVID tests and potential shutdowns of classrooms. Administration is trying their best to assist in the notification process, but it is an overwhelming process when multiple classes are needing contact tracing notifications at the same time. So our staff and administrator will always go above and beyond to try and make sure that our families are informed in a timely manner of school COVID policies and procedures, but we do need a new COVID contact tracing company as soon as possible. We are running ragged. Our families and staff deserve an efficient and safe process for COVID containment. But I did want to thank you guys for listening to me tonight, and I wanted to thank my classroom parents who have tuned in to the board meeting tonight to hear what I had to say to you all for about this, the situation in my classroom right now. And I wanted to thank my colleagues and my site administrator who have also tuned in tonight. And thank you again to the board and to Dr. Mitchell for listening to me as well. Stay safe and well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, the board recognizes Melissa Ochoa. Ms. Ochoa? Melissa Ochoa.
See a.
Do you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Hold on a moment. Okay, I'm just gonna go ahead and speak without my camera. But good evening, everybody. Thank you for listening to me. I didn't know what to put on like the open session, closed session. I wasn't sure. So thank you. So my concern right now is that our schools need help. They're overwhelmed. Our teachers are overwhelmed. Our staff is overwhelmed. They're exhausted. I truly feel so sad. Like, I don't know how they can handle all this, but I don't know what we're doing about it. I do see some CDC guidelines that have changed for healthcare workers, that they're allowed to go back to work with the virus as long as they're asymptomatic, which I think it's kind of crazy. But I know that we have staff and teachers that are willing to go back to work, you know, and all they ask is that they don't have to get the vaccination, and they are healthy. They don't have the virus, and they can't go back to work, and they're willing to work. So I don't understand how asymptomatic people or healthcare workers can go back to work now without isolating and without tests. A negative test, and you know, our staff that is willing to go back to work can't, just because of the fact that they have a vaccination or they don't have a vaccination, when we know the vaccination is not stopping the spread of COVID. So yeah, that's like my main issue right now. And I don't know, I'm not sure what it is, what's being done, but I don't know how we reconcile these two things, you know. It seems just, it doesn't make sense to me. So I'm just praying for our, you know, our board, and I pray that you guys, or we are all able to help our schools, because I've seen very, very overwhelmed people, and I'm just very concerned. Okay, well, thank you, and that's pretty much it right now.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam President. That concludes our public comments.
Okay. All right. So I want to thank all those who spoke, and let's go on to 9.001, governing board members' reports and announcements. Ooh, I forgot. Got to bring my sticks. Do I have any volunteers of who wants to go first?
I'll go if nobody else wants
that's
to.
That's great. All right. Thank you, Trustee Ekka.
Okay.
Because we okay, all are scared to get picked.
I'm going to try to talk fast because I know we're taking up so much time. Okay. First of all, to address that last caller, I just want them to know, honestly, if I had a teaching credential and I heard even one teacher was out, I would be there. I would totally be there. I wish I could do something, but I don't have a teaching credential. All I can do is just pray that we have people that will step up or just do something to help, you know, anything. You know, we need our kids to be taught. We need them to be in good hands. So I agree with that last caller. We got to start doing something, because this, I don't think it's going to get any better anytime real soon, but I do believe in the future, near future, it will. So just wanted to say that. Okay, now getting back to what I wrote. Okay, so just real quickly, I have a lot to say, but I'll be very respectful as I possibly can be. I've been under attack for a long time now, and I've been dealing with it with God's grace. I stand firm with my beliefs and convictions. I don't agree with the mandates and our freedoms taken away. I will keep standing up for what's right. The Constitution and our independence, I'm here to protect and help educate our children. I will never vote yes to vaccinate our children with an unapproved, unapproved or experimental vaccines. That is a parent's choice and their right. I'm a mother also, and I want that right too. I pray for this district and everyone here. Please educate and get the facts before you do anything. Have faith over fear. Trust in God if you are a believer. He's bigger than any pandemic. I just want to thank you all. I pray everybody stays safe and healthy. And I just really hope we get through this very soon, and that hopefully some court out there will just see the reason that this doesn't need to be happening the way it's happening. We need to all be working, surviving, paying our bills. I'm really not liking what's going on. It's very unconstitutional and just really bothers me. So I just wanted to put my two cents out there. I do support the vaxxed and the unvaxxed. And I just want everybody to know that there is hope. There is hope. We just need to hang in there and have faith and stay strong. So that's all I wanted to say. And just thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Trustee La French.
Well, good evening. I want to thank everyone for joining us. I know that the times that we're going through right now, I hear everything that everyone says. I thank you for your emails as well. I get up every day, you know, I work 9 hours out of the day, you know, in education. I understand both sides. I know that we're going through right now some times that we've never encountered. And I know it may seem as if that every day we're making up something new or something different. And that's because every day something changes. One day it could be 14 days, one day it could be 10 days. And last time I heard it could be 5 days, you know, if people quarantine, whether you're vaccinated, you're unvaccinated. I'm here, I understand there's no easy way to solve this. We're all going through it together. And tonight I'm very ill, I don't feel well, my body is sore. I pray over myself. I want to say, you know, I hope everyone of you, you know, stay safe. And I'm thankful that you guys are here in order for us to, you know, work together. I think that it's so important that the times that we are going through right now, that, you know, it's important to be able to lean on one another and work together rather than to pull apart. But you guys have a nice evening and please stay safe.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. Trustee Turner.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight. I know it's a difficult time for everyone. You know, I've experienced in my own family, you know, grandchildren coming down with COVID, and I know it's not easy to deal with that. Listening to you, we hear you. We hear your concern. I just want to thank everyone for everything that you do. You're going over and beyond working with our students and our staff. And I just want you to know that we hear you. Ms. Cadilli made a good point. Teachers are running out of sick leave. You know, we need to look into that. I mean, because if you can't come to work sick, you know, it will not help the situation. So hopefully the governor will look at that and give us some assistance, you know, and, you know, I'll be talking to the superintendent, see what we could do. You know, if we could use some of that ESSER money to help, you know, staff, you know, with sick leave, because we can't not have you not being paid. So anyway, hang in there. We're all in this together. I know you've heard me say that. And it's a very difficult time right now for everyone. But like Trustee LaFrench said, you know, let's depend on each other and pull up each other and help one another, and we can't get through this. I just want to say I did pass the vaccine sites on Saturday, and I was really happy to see the line that was out there being tested and also receiving the vaccine. And so we're going to keep working hard. We're going to, you know, keep doing what we need to do in order for Adelanto to be the best that we could be. This is not just Adelanto. This is going, this problem with staff calling out sick and ill with COVID symptoms or quarantine is happening around the country. So, and no one have a real solution, but we're working on it. And trust us and help us, and we'll get through this difficult time. So that's all I have. And thank you for joining in every board meeting. I see we have 94 participants tonight. And I just want you to know that we hear you and you know, we're gonna get through this. Thank you.
Thank you. Now it's my turn. I agree with my fellow trustees. These are stressful times. It's like somebody is just keeps winding that theme, you know? I mean, I'm in the classroom as well. And each time I get an email from my boss, it's like, oh, now what? And it's not her fault and it's not the email, but it seems like everything I realized little things are setting me off. I'm getting like stressed. I want to just curl up in a ball in bed. And, you know, sometimes I would just want to cry because it's like, it seems it's a never ending onslaught. And I know I'm not the only one feeling it. So I have to tell myself, you know, it's, you know, we just got to let, you know, we got to be kind. We got to show grace to ourselves and to each other. When I talk to friends or stuff, I always think, you know, responsibility. I got to be responsible for myself. Fall, following the protocols and then being respectful. One of the things that I teach my scholars is, you know, we gotta, you know, I really, really try to teach them the golden rule, treat of others the way you want to be treated. When I hear staff, they're stressed, you know, I feel it. I don't want you to be stressed. I don't want you, you know. And I do love how Trusty La French said, we need to lean on each other. I'm proud of our district and I'm proud of our community. You know, I love where I live. And, you know, we will get through this. You know, I hope that the governor, when he starts to pass his things, he realizes what he's doing to the boots on the ground, you know, because the boots on the ground are the ones being affected. Okay, so be kind to yourselves, take the bubble bath, whatever, I don't know, whatever you do to help de-stress. I'm trying hard not to eat a donut, so. I'll leave that they bring me joy. They bring me joy. I'm just gonna say that. Okay, so let's go on, please, and let's go on to 10, adoption of the minutes. Approve as written and or order filled regular board meeting of December 14th, 2021, and special board meeting of January 4th, 2022. And that's 10.01. Can I please get a motion?
Trustee Turner, I motion that we approve the minutes of December 14th, 2021, and special board meeting of January 4th, 2022.
Thank you. Can I please get a second?
I'll second.
Okay. I'll go ahead and give that one to Ekis. Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay. Can I have a vote, please?
Trustee Ekis?
Aye.
Trustee LaFrench?
LaFrench, aye.
Trustee Turner?
Trustee Turner, aye.
Trustee Bentz?
Trustee Bentz, aye. Motion Pat. Passes 4-0. Okay, moving on to the consent agenda. 11.0. We are taking items 11.02 through 11.17. Does any trustee want to pull an item?
Yes, I would like to pull 11.6 and 11.9.
Okay, so 11.006 and 11.009. Okay.
Yes.
Is there anything else a trustee would like to pull?
No, I don't.
No? Okay. And I have none. So I need a motion to approve the remaining items minus 11.06 and 11.09. Can I get
I motion to approve.
Okay. And I said that right? It was good? All right. Because I know I've messed up here in the consent part. So, all right. And I need a second, please.
Trustee Turner, I second.
Okay. Thank you. Can I get a vote, please?
Trustee Ekis? Trustee Ekis?
Aye.
Trustee LaFrench?
LaFrench, aye.
Trustee Turner.
Trustee Turner, aye.
And Trustee Benz.
Benz, aye. Motion passes 4-0. Okay, and now we're going to go on to 12.01, items removed from the consent agenda. I need a motion to address 11.06.
I motion to approve it.
Okay, I got a motion from Elkis to approve. Can I get a second, please?
I second LaFrench.
Thank you. Okay, we are open for discussion.
Okay, so the reason why I'm bringing this up is because I understand we do have this in our schools, and now this is a consent agenda item to put it in our district office. I think it's great. I have no problem with that. But I do have concerns, especially with what's been going on lately. And as a board member, I just feel it needs to be addressed. It needs to be talked about because it's a huge concern. The reason why I'm bringing this up is because I'm very concerned with the public, the strangers, the people that are coming on our campuses for testing. I kind of didn't know it was open to the public. I thought it was just for staff and our children. Hearing that we're opening our schools wide open to complete strangers really concerns me. I was under the impression the city has Maverick Stadium open for other people, and we need to safeguard our schools. I have seen things that are disturbing. I have heard things that are disturbing. I'm understanding that we have sick people coming on our campuses. We don't know anything about them. We don't even allow volunteers on campuses, but yet these people are allowed on our campuses. I've heard that even sick children that are coming to be tested are actually going out on the playground and playing with our healthy children. That's a concern. That is a huge concern. You already know in my previous statement, I do not like these mandates. I don't like any of it, the testing, any of it. I just think it's we're taking away our freedoms. But getting back to the Raptor system, yes, it's in place. Yes, we have it. Yes, I like it. Yes, it'll work. But if we're allowing complete strangers and we're letting our guard down during an epidemic, that concerns me. We need to stay on guard. We need to protect our students, protect our staff, and not allow complete strangers from the public on campus. Now, I'm just saying that because I needed to vent, but I've also been told earlier that we have stopped that. I hope that's true. I hope we don't go back to that. If we do, I certainly hope we have people that are going to be out there monitoring this and watching these strangers coming on our campuses, putting our campuses and our children in danger. That's pretty much all I wanted to say. I wanted to vent because I was just so taken back by what I've seen and what I've heard. And I just think we just can't let our guard down. So I've said my piece and I'll leave it at that. But this is a great program. I do like the Raptor service, and we do need to be very careful with who's coming on our campus. And I'm really glad to approve this tonight, especially for the DO during these times. So thank you. That's all I really wanted to say.
Any other trustee? Okay, so we had a motion to approve. We had a second. So let's please take a vote.
Trustee Ekis, aye.
Trustee LaFrench.
LaFrench, aye.
Trustee Turner.
Trustee Turner, aye.
Trustee Benz.
Benz, aye. Motion passes 4-0. Okay, now I need a motion for item 11.09.
Ekis, I motion to approve.
Okay, can I get a second?
Trustee Turner, I second.
Okay, we are open for discussion.
Okay, I pulled this because I'm very sad leaving our district, whether it's for retirement or other reasons. These are people that have been in our district for so long, and we're a family, and I'm really going to miss them. I'm basically pulling out Dorothy Campbell. I know there's others on here, and again, it just hurts to see you leave, but Dorothy Campbell is very special to me. She's been a mentor. She's been a wonderful, wonderful person. I mean, I just can't say enough about her. And to see she's retiring, I know she deserves it. And I know everybody has to do it at some point, but I'm sure going to miss her deeply. So I just wanted her to know that. And I just feel we need to really honor the people that are leaving our district for any reason. They deserve our respect and our love. So I just wanted to say that. That's why I pulled this item. So thank you.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. Is there any trustee who would like to speak on this?
Trustee Turner, I would like to just say, you know, I agree with what Trustee Eckes just said, you know, and Mrs. Campbell, thank you for your service to our district. We really appreciate, you know, the love and caring and nurturing that you've given our children over the years. And I know we're in the midst of a pandemic, and before this second wave happened, you know, we had planned to honor our retirees, you know, with the ceremony. And once we can get back in person, I still would like to do that, and hopefully we can get them to come back out. But we need to show our staff that served our district well, and at the retirement age that, you know, we care for them and the service that they've given us. You know, I had an employee come to me and say that she retired last month and gave our district 17 years, and no one said anything to her at the district office. So I don't want to hear that. That's not good. We need to acknowledge our retirees with something, and because they put in time and nurturing, especially not just teachers, but our CNS staff, our bus drivers, our clerks, everyone, you know, that serve our district. And we have long-term people working for us that served us 20, 25, 30 years. And so we need to do a better job in acknowledging their service to us. That's all I have. Thank you.
Trustee Lala French.
I want to say thank you for the time that you have served our district. I truly wish that it was me retiring. Enjoy your retirement. This is the best time to be able to retire and be able to go home. Have fun. Thank you.
Okay, so Trustee Lala French and I are in sync because I was like, oh, Miss Dorothy, I am so jealous that you can go off and retire and do what you want. If you want to go in another direction, you want to stay home and craft and bake, whatever, I wish you the best in your retirement. Thank you for your service to our kids and our district. It is very much appreciated. And please enjoy your retirement, okay? All right, so can we please have a vote on this item?
Yes, Trustee Eckes.
Aye.
Trustee LaFrench.
LaFrench, aye.
Trustee Turner.
Trustee Turner, aye.
Trustee Benz.
Benz, aye. Motion passes 4-0. So now we are going to go on to 13 staff reports and presentations. 13.001, school information binders.
Thank you, Trustee Benz. I'd like to invite Dr. Tasha Dwyer on to. About a year ago, Ms. Turner requested some school information for each school. And so I'm happy to report that we sent you those binders. And so I've asked Dr. Dwyzon to share briefly what's in those binders and what we plan on adding to those binders and how the board might use those binders. So Dr. Dwyzon, thank you.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Mitchell. Good evening, Board President Bentz, Board of Trustees, AESD staff, and community. I would like to give the board an overview of the site information binders you received this week. The binder was compiled and developed by our academic services team for the board and the cabinet to use as they visit our school sites. It's designed to give you a general overview and profile of each school collectively and individually. The binders were created to allow our board and cabinet to get a glimpse into the journey each site is undertaking. So section one, if you have your notebook in front of you, section one lists the 21-22 school evaluators. Each assistant superintendent provides guidance and oversight for the sites. This allows for maximum communication and support for the sites as needed. If you flip to section two, this is our professional learning and collaboration plan overview. This is a glimpse of all sites collectively together on one document. And it also highlights any special programs such as the Early Literacy Block Grant, Comprehensive Support, or CSI schools or ATSI. That's the additional targeted support and improvement. And these are state identified programs in which we monitor their implementation based on the funds we received for them being identified. Section three is just a section for you to, if you have to, any notes or any follow-ups you want, that's just a section for you to have just some blank pages. Section four will be the district overview of the start times and the bell schedules for the district as a whole. Now, sections 5 through 18, those are each school site individually. So in the school profiles that we've assembled following for each site, you'll have the teachers, the grades, and any special programs that are offered on the campus, such as special education. Additionally, you will have the bell schedules for each of the school sites, as they all are a little bit different. And then you also have school maps. So you're able to just at a glimpse, see where teachers may be located. Additionally, in their information section, they have their professional learning and collaboration plan. So this is where in section two, it was the overview of all schools. This is the more detailed plan for each site individually. So each, and this is where they've identified their focus areas collectively as a school. And this is where they focus their time in professional learning. So it could be things like reading. We have many of our schools, actually the majority of our schools, focused on reading. We also have SEL identified, some math. So that's just to name a few. And then finally, in each individual school profile, you'll also see their single plan for student achievement overview. So these were also added so that you had a complete picture of what was happening at the school sites. So these site information binders will be updated as needed with key information to add as they become available. And we're certain that these will provide you with information that is both timely and relevant to each school site. So thank you.
Any trustees have any questions?
No, but I wanted to commend them on what a great job they did. It's very nice. Mm-hmm. I'm impressed. It's very, very nice. So thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
I totally agree. When I received this binder and I looked through it, I'm like, wow, this is amazing. This is absolutely amazing. And I know it took some time to put this all together, but, you know, it's good to know, you know, have this and understand what's happening, the different programs at each individual school and, you know, the map, all of it. This is just, whoever did this did a phenomenal job. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Mitchell. And the Academic Services Department. Thank you.
Trustee La French, you want to Chirping, or are you good?
I don't never want to, you know, like chop your last name up. So I very rarely say it, but this was so nice to look at. I love to see the maps of the schools, and just, you know, it was like really, I felt like I was like inside of the school where you could just go and look and reference, you know. We greatly appreciate it. It's really, really nice. Very neat, you know. So thank you. I appreciate it.
Yes, I loved it. First thing, I just love binders, like my classroom and my house. I got binders for everything. Everything I got binders. I am thankful for the information. So now I got to sit and really, because I want to know what's in it and not just know what's in it. You know what I mean, right? I want to kind of, because there's so much information. So thank you for the effort on that. I know it was a lot. So I appreciate it very, very much. Okay, so let's go on to 13.02, COVID-19 update.
Thank you, Trustee Bence. Board, as promised, staff will give an update on our COVID-19 current protocols and some of the things facing us in terms of our response to the need for contact tracing and doing that internally. So I've asked staff to give a high level overview. And so we'll have Mr. Krause, Mr. Moran, and Dr. Dwyzon presenting these next few slides. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mitchell. So,
I apologize, Mr. Quintero, public information presenting. So thanks so much. Sorry about that, Stephen.
That's okay, I gotcha. So good evening, President Bence, trustees, Superintendent Dr. Mitchell, cabinet members, staff and guests, and happy new year, by the way. As Dr. Mitchell said, I am Steve Quintero, the public information officer. Mr. Krause and Mr. Moran will be providing details on the COVID-19 protocols as well. And so next slide, please. Tonight, Mr. Krause, Mr. Moran, and I will provide information on the following objectives: K-12 schools, guidance overview, district safety protocols, status of contact tracing, and testing for staff and students. So next slide. So I wanted to take a moment to explain how guidelines are developed and the announcement of an update to the guidelines. And so I think this is fitting based on the conversation this evening that we've had. So first and foremost, the Center for Disease Control actually develops the COVID-19 public health and safety recommendations. And then each state in the US can review these recommendations and follow the CDC recommendations, or they can establish more stringent guidelines. And so the California Department of Public Health actually has adopted some of the CDC guidelines, but they have also developed more stringent guidelines for the state. And they've also created different guidelines for not only for the OSHA and regular working professionals, but also for the K-12 schools. And so the state created and published a K-12 school guidance overview on November 24th was the last update. So what happens in regards to the district and the entire state, each of the districts and the schools are to follow the K-12 schools guidance. And that's why it gets a little confusing, because some people say the CDC says this, the CDPH says that. Well, currently our jurisdiction is the K-12 school guidance overview. And so that is the one we have to review. What's important to note is, and you may have heard this in the news, on December 27th, 2021, CDC did an update on their guidelines, and specifically with isolation and quarantines. And then on January 8th, the California Department of Public Health updated their guidelines, and they are slightly different than the CDC. They're actually more stringent. And so last week, on January 9th, State Superintendent Tony Thurmond announced that they were going to do an update to the K-12 schools guidance. And so we are expecting changes, So what we know today may change if the announcement come out tomorrow or Thursday. He tends to do a lot of announcements on Thursday via Facebook. So we'll be keeping an ear out for that announcement. And so the next slide, Mr. Krause.
Yes, thank you, Mr. King Chair. Good evening, members of the board, members of the community. As we move through this presentation, just want to briefly update you on our safety protocols that have been in place. For example, staff and students will wear their face masks properly inside. And one of the things our sites have really been working with our staff and helping our students understand is it has to cover the mouth. That's one of the biggest things that we see, that staff students may be wearing the mask, but it may not cover the nose all the way. So that's very important that we keep working on that with all of our stakeholders. Also, physical distancing, social distancing on the bus or in the classroom. At this time, there's no guidance on that. And so as we move forward, again, as Mr. Quintero stated, as guidance changes, we will determine how to implement that within our district. Also, the exposure protocol when it comes to contact tracing and quarantine. Staff and students will self-screen at home for COVID-19 symptoms. And so we have issued all of our staff thermometers that they can scan their foreheads at home. And we continue to distribute those as an on-needed basis so that before staff come in, they're able to do that. And we've encouraged our families to also screen their students before they send them to school. And then staff and students will sanitize and wash hands frequently. So these are some of our safety protocols that have been implemented, and we continue to encourage and work with our stakeholders on implementing across the district. And with that, next slide, Mike. And then this slide just briefly talks about our contact tracing transition. And so currently, as we are implementing a transition plan where the district is taking over temporary oversight of the contact tracing process. And so there's a command center that has been set up at the Professional Development Center at Old George in the library, and staff are being trained to contact trace suspected and positive cases. We had a training today. We have several more this week for staff. There were 42 people that joined us for the COVID-19 training done by our Director of Risk Management today via Zoom. And we will continue to do that until we are supporting all of our sites with as much training as needed. We also are flying currently a request for proposals. And a request for proposal was flown on January 5th. And what that is that it requests companies to solicit a bid. They basically say, this is what we can do contact tracing for your district and staff. One of the requirements in there is that they have all staff at all sites. They would have a staff member of their team at all sites. That's a minimum requirement. One of the things in the scope of work, there's many other things in there, but that's a minimum. And then for potential approval, on January 25th at the board meeting on January 25th. And so we hope that they will get started soon after that, but we gave them a deadline, a hard deadline of February 15th. We believe that they possibly will be started before then. But again, we have the internal district transition team assisting with COVID-19 tracing right now. And with that, next slide, Mike. And I'm gonna turn that information about the high level overview of contact tracing over to Mr. Moran at this time. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Krause. Good evening, everybody. So on this slide, this side is we're just sharing a high level overview of what we're doing with staff. So as Michael mentioned, staff is going to be trained in the interim to provide contact tracing. Some of the things they'll be doing is answering the COVID support emails, telephone calls, and voicemails. We're also in the process of identifying full-time staff to be compensated with a stipend for these additional duties that will be assigned. Part-time staff will also be offered additional hours to support staff who are manning the contact tracing, if it in fact is, say, an office employee, as such as a secretary or a clerk or anybody else. But again, this also requires negotiations with our CSCA colleagues for such stipend. So thankfully, we have a list of people who are interested. And I don't want to forget, but I just want to thank the various stakeholders from CSCA, ADTA, various office, school staff, managers, principals who provided input and ideas to consider as we do our best to get through this contact tracing in the interim. We met Thursday at a union district meeting. We met again on Friday. Some of us met on Saturday morning, as well as a Sunday evening with a group of people who were interested in this. So I just wanted to remind myself to thank everybody this evening. So as these employees are able to help us, part of their work would be addressing staff and families who email us or call us to give next steps. You know, such as when there's positive cases, we have specific letters that are sent to employees or parents of students who are positive to identify them, to provide them with specific information in regards to their next steps for their own health. In addition, anybody who is a possible exposure would be considered a close contact, and there are specific letters for those employees, or that close contact letter goes to the parents of those students. And then there's other letters such as employee notifications. These are just general letters that go out that these folks who eventually will be trained will send to folks that are not considered close contact, what we're calling non-close contacts. And so that information will also contain kind of return to work or school dates. And again, part of that training and overview will be handled by Josie, who's in our director of risk management position. And then as Michael shared earlier, we have a district command center. They're gonna be there for additional support and track all cases in conjunction with assigned staff at the sites. So again, this is just a quick overview of those contact tracing ideas, and more specific information will be provided during those trainings. And again, as Michael mentioned earlier, there was a big group that got trained today as a first piece of that. And with that, I'll pass it on to our next presenter. I think it goes back to Stephen, or no, to Michael. Thank you.
Hey, thank you, Mr. Moran. And here we just wanted to briefly talk about the COVID-19 testing program. We really appreciate the board approving HEAL 360 to come on board and support us in our testing. They are at various sites throughout the week. So they are testing every day, but the site location changes. So that way they can make sure they are moving around the district in order to test at the various sites. And yes, we know there is a surge in demand for testing. We have worked with the city to ensure that they put out more information related to the testing going on at the Adelanto Stadium from 9 to 5 Monday through Friday. So that's where we're really encouraging our community to go to over there. But there are long lines there as well. The state of California also is providing school districts with at-home testing kits for students. The San Bernardino County Superintendent of Schools received 7,000 plus at-home testing kits for our district. We're excited to say that we will be picking them up this week and working on implementing a distribution plan to our families to get those into the hands of our families. Each kit contains 2 tests for a family. So if you have 2 children, you get 2 test kits, but a total of 4 tests because there's 2 in each. And so, but we are working with HEAL 360 to extend the hours of testing as well as we move forward. And so with that, I'll turn it over to the next person. Mike, if you can advance the slide. Thank you very much. Mr. Quintero.
My apologies about the mute. So we'll just continue to monitor the updates and look for the new announcement from State Superintendent Tony Thurman later this week. Hopefully it comes out. We'll continue to monitor the High Desert and San Bernardino County for cases and outbreaks. We'll remind staff, as we did last week, and students of the safety guidelines and protocols. And then, as always, we'll continue to make adjustments as we have been doing since the pandemic first started in March 2020, and make appropriate decisions based on the information we have available to us. And so this is just a general overview of the COVID-19 overview. So we thank you very much.
That concludes our presentation, board. Any questions? You're on mute, Ms. Benz.
My bad, sorry. Board, do you have any questions about the presentation?
I don't have any questions. I'm looking forward to a more detailed protocol, though.
Trustee Atkins, I know that you mentioned that you had questions. Did you want to ask those questions at this time?
Well, I kind of forgot my questions, but yeah, I mean, I'm just really curious, like if, I don't know, like if, what if everything just stops tomorrow? What if the Supreme Court says that we no longer have to do any of this? I mean, is that a possibility? I just don't understand or grasp the whole thing because I do listen to, you know, the news and I'm hearing it on a bigger scale with companies of 100 or more employees, but I'm not really hearing a lot about what are our rights and what can we do and not do for school districts, for board members. I'm just not getting that information and I want to know where we stand, what are our rights? Because I know a lot of other school districts are going against these mandates. They're putting in policies, they're putting in resolutions. And our district, of course, isn't doing any of that. And I at least want to know what our options are and what are they doing that's so different than what we're doing. And I just feel as a board member, I need to know more about how these mandates are affecting our districts, our children, our employees. I just don't feel like I grasp it or understand it enough. So I don't know, maybe that's just me, but that's just kind of how I feel and where I stand on this. So I don't know, maybe somebody can try to help me a little bit with that and understand, you know, again, what our rights are as school districts.
So Trustee Atkins, I'll try to take a shot at it. It would be helpful if you told me what specific district you're talking about so I can get a better sense of exactly what you're doing. But I think you may be talking about some districts that have said that they would not enforce a mandate for vaccination if the governor put one out. So at this moment, there is no vaccine mandate. What's in force right now is that all staff must attest as to their vaccination status. Our staff has done that. And those members of our staff who are not vaccinated are compelled to submit to weekly surveillance testing in order to continue working. We've shared where our data sits with that. So there are some districts that put out resolutions, at least two that I know, that says something like this, that if the governor mandates children to be vaccinated, we won't be complying. Now, if you remember, I shared a letter with the board from our JPA that said, if we do not follow the governor's mandate, that we would not be, board members would not be covered under the Joint Powers Authority or JPA, which is our insurance company. So we got sued, let's just say for example, we didn't enforce the governor's current mandate and we allowed staff to come to work not vaccinated and not be tested. And let's say that another staff member gets sick and dies. And let's say that family sues the district. Well, the JPA is saying that if we fail to follow that mandate, the individual board members will be liable, as well as myself, as well as any of our cabinet staff and so on and so forth, as well as the principal and so on and so forth. So what we are compelled to do is that the governor's mandates there's not a choice to follow them. They are legally enforceable. And we are compelled to follow the governor's mandate. The other thing I think I can speak to, Trustee Atkins, if I could, is that the governor Newsom, about a month or two ago, he did say he would require a mandate once the vaccinations were fully approved by the FDA. He has yet to issue that mandate. I don't know if he's changed his plans on doing that. We'll have to see, but if that's the case, my recommendation to the board will be to follow the mandate if that comes out. It has not yet. I know there's a lot of anxiety about it, it may come out. I know there's a lot of protests and a lot of angst out there around if he may do this or not. But so for one, we know he hasn't yet. And for number two, if he does issue a mandate for all age groups to be vaccinated before coming to school, my recommendation to the board would be to follow that mandate or be open to lawsuit if we don't. So I hope that helps. I know I'm kind of shooting in the dark, but if you have a particular district that you hear they're doing X or Y, I'm happy to look at that district's policy and analyze it and give the board our take on their policy as it relates to Alonzo.
Okay, thank you. Yes, I can give you a list. It's a very long list of school districts in California that are doing or saying something against the mandates that are happening now. I do understand the vaccine for the children is coming soon. That's a whole nother subject that it's going to get nasty. It's going to be a whole nother deal. But I do have a question for you. I do understand that they're talking about unvaccinated people getting vaccinated people sick or vice versa. And I understand what the JP's doing, but we're not addressing the other issue of people that are vaccinated and giving other people the COVID. You can give it and get it still if you're vaccinated. Nobody's addressing that. The governor's not addressing it. And I know vaccinated people are making other people sick, whether they're vaccinated or not. And they don't have to be tested. Nobody's looking twice at them. They're coming to big public events thinking that they're safe because they're vaccinated. What about lawsuits that can generate from that? Where we keep looking at the unvaccinated, but we need to look at the vaccinated. They can still get people sick. And, I'll give you an example. If I'm on campus and I'm not vaccinated, or my child and somebody who is vaccinated was there and they don't have to be tested and they got me or my child sick, I'm going to want to look at a lawsuit too. So it works out. It goes both ways. And I just feel nobody's addressing that. And, JP, I think, needs to look at that issue too. So yes, it's a nasty thing. I understand that, but there's a lot more legs to it. And I have to grasp it and try to understand it the best I can. So I understand what you're saying. I hear you, but I really wish people or someone would address the other side of it, because that is an issue that does need to be addressed. So anyway, I'll let it go with that, but thank you for your explanation and hopefully, we'll all just kind of learn from this, I guess. Thank you.
And Trustee Atkins, if you want to give me a couple of districts I can look into, because Trustee Atkins, you're right. Some districts are doing some creative stuff out there. And I would definitely be interested in bringing what works to our district as well. So, sometimes I don't know what I don't know. And so if you can point me in the right direction, I'd be happy to look into that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, so any other questions? Okay, so let's go on to new business, 14.01. Business services approval of the agreement with the project's support services for division of state architects, project closeout support phase one.
Yes, so thank you, Trustee Bates. I'm going to turn it over to Michael to translate this effort. So thank you, Ms. Krause.
Thank you, Dr. Mitchell. So before the board this evening is a agreement with Project Support Services. And what they do is help many districts, close out Division of State Architect construction projects. So in the past, in Adelanto Elementary School District, there is at least 9 projects that for whatever reason were never fully closed out with Division of State Architects. That's who oversees all facilities projects on school sites and campuses. And it could be something as simple as a signature. It could be something that more major that a architect's plans were not submitted to DSA. Nonetheless, it's a liability for the district because they haven't been fully closed out and approved by the Division of State Architects. And so what we want to do is make sure that we get that accomplished as soon as possible. And that will then clear us from having any any non-closed projects with the Division of State Architects. And so project support services will come in, assist us with what needs to be done, and then work with DSA directly as they do with many other districts to get our projects closed out. And this will again be a great opportunity to reduce the liability, because if something were to happen now potentially and they're not closed out, the district's liable for not having that DSA closeout approval letter, which we would get at the end of the process. And so phase one before you this evening is for them to assess and then see how much they can get closed out. And there might be a phase two, depending on how much work they discover needs to be done with the Division of State Architects. So hopefully that helps a little bit on what this project is, but we're excited to bring this to the board this evening to get the process going potentially. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Can I get a motion to approve?
Trustee Turner, I motion that we approve.
Okay, Turner. Can I get a second?
I second, Ickes.
Thank you. We're open for discussion.
I do have a question. Yes, I do have a question, Mr. Krause. Your background indicate that you cited 9 construction projects that the district hasn't closed out. So this company will go in, look at those 9 projects, and if they determine that other projects need to be closed out, then we'll enter phase 2. Is that what you're saying?
They will determine how much work needs to be done to close out these 9. Again, some might be as simple as a signature missing, and DSA will not approve it without that signature on a document, perhaps. But there could be more intense work that needs to be done, and that would be before anything is done for phase 2, we bring back that to the board in a report of what we found in phase 1 for the board's consideration to move forward into the next steps of phase 2, potentially. But there may not be a phase 2, Trustee Turner, if there's not a whole lot of work that needs to be done, if it's just a simple couple of things that need to be done.
Oh, okay. I got it. Okay, thank you.
Okay, and any other questions? Okay, can I get a vote,
please? Trustee Ickes?
Aye.
Trustee LaFrench?
LaFrench, aye.
Trustee Turner?
Trustee Turner, aye.
And Trustee Bentz?
Bentz, aye. Motion passes 400. Okay, we're going to go on to 15, superintendent's report.
Thank you, board. Please excuse my voice a little under the weather tonight and hugely congested, so I'll keep my report short. I just want to thank the board for your work on the trustee area maps. I wanted to let you know that the new maps meet all the requirements of the California Voting Act's requirement and are now posted on the district website. Additionally, as required by law, the maps were filed with the San Bernardino County Superintendent Schools Office 2 weeks ago. So thank you for your work there, or 1 week ago. Also, board, I would like to thank you for your work on the trustee area application for board appointment that is posted on the website. I just want to take for the benefit of the community, I just want to take a minute to just walk through the timeline. So January 4th, the board announced its intention to begin the process of a provisional appointment for interested candidate to fill the vacated seat. So from January 4th to January 16th, the district will advertise the vacancy and provisional appointment process, and the candidate may submit applications. On January 17th, all applications are due to my office from between January 18th and January 21st. The applications will be reviewed and screened by a committee of the board, who is Trustees Love French and Trustee Ickes. So I will set up a meeting, Trustee Bentz, just to facilitate the trustees a review of that. So we'll make copies of everything. We'll give them some coffee and just be a support to the committee. On January 21st, the district will post the names of the candidate to be interviewed by the end of the day on our website. And then on January 25th, which is the regular board meeting of the trustees, the district will interview each candidate during open session. And then the board will vote to select the provisional appointee during open session. And then on or before January 29th, the district will vote, post a notice of the vacancy and the provisional appointment, and then publish it in the newspaper as required by law, because voters have the right to call for a special election within 30 days of the appointment. So people might say, hey, we're concerned about this appointment, and the community itself can call for a special election. And so the board, I just want to make it clear that the appointee will hold office until the next governing board election, which occurs at the next statewide general election on November 8th, 2022. So this person would finish the term and then be required to run officially for the position. I just wanted to review that for the benefit of the public. Thank you. And then I have a few more announcements. We're looking forward to the governor's meeting next week, where we will be able to hear the governor's budget proposal. We're hearing some really good things initially, this budget will be a record funding for public schools and community colleges. And then on January 25th, board, we've asked Matt Phillips from School Services of California to partner with Mr. Krause in a joint presentation to the board, kind of unpacking what's in the governor's budget for next year. I did want to give an update on the vaccination clinic held this past Saturday. I was at both of them. We held vaccination clinics at Mesa Linda Middle School and Adelanto Elementary School from 11 to 3 last Saturday. And at Mesa Linda, we tested 60 people and we vaccinated 104. And at Adelanto Elementary, we tested 84 people and vaccinated 66 people. So we had 170 people vaccinated and 150 people tested. So just wanted to give a report on that our people are coming out for these vaccinations. What I'm particularly proud of is that access to healthcare is a little sparse behind in the north side of our district. And so we did provide transportation and a shuttle service to get folks around and went very well this past Saturday. I also want to report that you may have heard in the news that San Bernardino County was supposed to be getting 2 test kits per family. The rest of the California got them. San Bernardino County did not. We're set to pick up our test kits on Wednesday. Is that tomorrow, Mr. Krause, or next Wednesday?
Dr. Mitchell, that will be tomorrow. We are coordinating with the county, and we will have those hopefully in hand tomorrow.
Perfect. Thank you so much. So that'll be two test kits per family. And we're hoping that's just a drop in the bucket, because we think that providing broader access to testing will help keep our families safe and our staff safe if you're able to know that you have COVID or not. So I also want to let the board know that we did start our program called SchoolMint, which is basically an electronic registration system. So we're transitioning all of our registration to this electronic platform called SchoolMint, and we're going to start operating it in the next couple of weeks. And lastly, I just want to make an announcement that we have physical fitness testing coming up for all of our 5th and 7th graders beginning in February. So I think as was mentioned by Ms. Cadilli, that we still are required to do the state testing. The physical fitness test is one part of the state testing, and that will begin in February for all 5th and 7th graders. That's my report, thank you.
All right, thank you. I guess we can go to adjournment. Does that sound good? All right, so 16.001, can I get a motion to adjourn?
Trustee Turner, motion that we adjourn.
Okay, and I need a second.
Trustee LaFrench, I second.
All right, can I get a vote, please?
Trustee Eckes?
I wanted to ask a question and I was muted and then my computer went out. Oh. Can I back up for a minute? I wanted to know how many people were vaccinated on Saturday?
Let's see here. We have, I'll mute. Okay.
No, you're fine.
Thank you. We vaccinated 104 people at Mesa Linda and 66 at Adelanto Elementary for a total of 170.
Okay, and these were vaccines or testing?
Well, we vaccinated 170 people. We gave tests to about 150 people. We had two different lines. We had folks there for testing, and we had folks there for vaccination.
Do you have a breakdown of the children that were vaccinated, or is that as a whole?
That's as a whole, but I can get that data. I did provide for the Saturday before that, but I can get that data. Mr. Krause, thank you.
Okay, and do you know what vaccine they used?
All Pfizer, and because Pfizer and J&J are the only ones approved right now. Is that correct, Mr. Krause?
I believe so. I'll definitely provide that information along with the how many children in that report to you, Dr. Mitchell, for the board.
Thank you.
Okay. And one more question. Do they sign a waiver of any kind when they get the vaccine?
A waiver for what? Go ahead.
To release liability of any kind?
The vaccine clinic was provided by the County of San Bernardino Department of Health, and I am not privy to their paperwork. I know that they had to sign something, but we can definitely get a copy from them. I'll also request that and provide it in the information about the vaccines as well.
Okay, I would appreciate that. Thank you. Okay, I'm sorry. We can go back to adjournment.
And can we get the vote?
Yes, Trustee Eckes?
Aye.
Trustee LaFrench?
LaFrench, aye.
Trustee Turner?
Trustee Turner, aye.
And Trustee Bentz?
Bentz, aye. Motion passes 4-0. The time is now 9:32. Please have a great night and a great rest of the week. All right.
Good night, everyone.
Thank you. Good night. Good night. Good night.